Hello, welcome to Swedish's Facebook Live. I'm Mona Locke, Chief Communications Officer, and I want to talk a little bit about Swedish. We are the largest nonprofit healthcare system in Washington State, with 5 hospital campuses, 115 clinics, and 2 freestanding emergency departments. And we've been here on the forefront of COVID-19 since it hit Seattle, and we thought that we wanted to host this Facebook Live to make sure that we can answer the questions that you, the public, have for us real time. So make sure you chat in those questions so that we can get them answered within the next half hour. We also have a panel of experts today to talk about our topic, which is behavioral health and wellness. It is facing all of us, whether we're at work, whether you're at home, and especially on Thursday with Governor Inslee's announcement that he was going to extend the stay home, stay healthy through the beginning of May. We are some isolated with our family members, which is good or bad, and we are at work or in apartments, and so there's a lot of anxiety around that. And we wanted to address that topic today with 2 of our experts, who I'll let introduce themselves and give you a little bit about what's on their plate. Mm-hmm. So we'll start with Dr. O'Donnell.
Hi, I'm Dr. Jenny O'Donnell. I am the Clinical Program Director for our Behavioral Health Integration Program at Swedish. And I am a licensed clinical psychologist with a research background in self-care and wellness. So this topic has really been near and dear to my heart. We've been working really since COVID started to hit the Seattle area in particular. We've been trying to shift all of our behavioral health resources at Swedish to being virtual, either by telephone or by video, so that we're able to really meet the needs of our community without adding additional exposure risks for our caregivers or our community. So we've been doing a lot of work, very long hours, trying to get everything lifted. I know that our employee health has been working diligently on caregiver wellness, as well as some larger system efforts on caregiver wellness specifically. But my program is really emphasizing how we support our community, how we help our patients to access healthcare and their mental health, because we have to be emotionally well in order to fight off these infections as well. It's a really key component of our wellness in general. So we are figuring out how to deliver services, both our traditional behavioral health integration in primary care, in some of our specialty clinics, as well as our psychiatric partial hospitalization programs and our inpatient units. We're really trying to figure out how we can support patients before they need those more acute services. So I think that's one of the biggest things that I've noticed, is because everyone is feeling this at some level, I don't think any one of us is immune to the stress and the anxiety that we've been facing. But I think everybody is finding it's not as bad for me. There are people that are worse. There's other people that are in need. And so with this increased community perspective, people are not accessing the care that's available to them because they don't want to take away from somebody else. So if there's one message I can really start off with today, it's that the resources are there, whether it's through Swedish or through any other mental health professionals. The professionals across the country have all been stepping up and wanting to serve our communities. So reach out, even if it's just for 1 or 2 sessions, really make sure that you're taking care of yourself so that you can take care of your families and the community.
I'll have so many questions on this, but I want to first go to Dr. Sachdeva. Yeah.
Thank you, Mona. It's a pleasure to be here. My name is Sandeep Sachdeva. I'm a board certified internal medicine physician. I'm also board certified in palliative and hospice care, which is near and dear to my heart. I've been with Swedish for 20 years and I have an administrative job as well. I'm the chief medical officer at Swedish Edmonds and also for our Swedish Mill Creek facility. One of my passions has been working on wellness, particularly focused on our caregivers. And even before the COVID crisis started, we had formed a team at Swedish looking at how can we care for our caregivers, recognizing that that is so important for our caregivers to be there for our community. Somebody needs to care for them. And how do we do that in a fashion that our caregivers are most optimized in the best shape form to look after our community members. So it's just a pleasure to be working with the Dr. O'Donnell's team and so many others, our spiritual care team members, and I could name a few other teams, and it's just the passion around it is just immense. And once the COVID crisis hit, the desire, the sense of urgency to work on wellness was more than ever before, and it just sort of energized us to sort of double down on how do we do this in a fashion that really helps our caregivers. So I really appreciate the fact that we are talking about it today.
Yeah, I think as Dr. O'Donnell said, it impacts all of us. And so I just want to start out with a general question of, you know, I'm stuck at home. We have stay at home, stay healthy. I want to get out and I want to socialize. What should I do?
So I'll jump in with that one to start. There are so many things that we can do. I've seen a ton of things coming through all of the professional listservs on Facebook and, you know, wherever you're getting care, there's information galore. But some of the standard things that I think are helpful now are the same things that are helpful in our daily lives outside of this crisis. So some of the things that, regardless of the stay home order, that are really important are things like finding opportunities to get some physical activity. Movement is so essential to our wellness and our ability to fight infection. I would also emphasize structure and routine. Outside of this, one of the things that I find is most indicative of depression and increasing depression and anxiety is that lack of structure, lack of routine, and opportunities to connect socially. So making sure that you are still getting up and doing certain things every day, making sure you're taking care of your health and wellness in terms of eating and sleeping and that physical activity. But also, you know, trying to engage in some connection in some way. I have seen so many people doing a variety of connection, whether it's through Facebook comments, if it's texting, it's really getting back to not waiting for that opportunity to go out and meet up for a drink or to go have lunch or brunch with a friend. It's really trying to be creative and connect in other ways. So I've even talked to some people that, you know, maybe technology is not their best friend, which it's not for all of us. So going back to letter writing, I've seen a lot of people, myself included, I send handwritten cards to people on a regular basis, and that practice has helped me to feel connected, even if I'm not able to meet up in person.
Yeah, I mean, I think that also begs a good question for the elderly. I mean, so often the elderly who are most at risk, we say, make sure you stay at home. How do they cope? And they don't have the resources like the internet and Facebook that they don't necessarily use.
You know, I just want to kind of paraphrase what Dr. O'Donnell said, and before answering about our respected elderly, is that the way I've been talking about wellness is the four M's. Mm-hmm. You know, the first M being mindfulness, and just the notion of being there in the present, being in the now, experiencing, feeling your environment, not letting the past or the future sort of linger too much in your mind. The other M is mobility that you touched upon. It's so very important. I certainly believe in the mind-body connection. And so if your mind is at peace, your body is going to be healthier. And if your body is healthier, it helps your mind. So in other words, if you're physically exercising, no matter what exercise means to you, it could be just light walking, or it could be something more strenuous, but something that you're able to do on a regular basis and have fun at it, you know, moving around. You know, so mobility is super important. Again, that mind-body connection. And then you also talked about meaningful connection, you know, letter writing, pick up the phone, great time. If you have a friend you haven't connected with, call them up and ask them, hey, how are you doing? And mean that question. And if somebody says, how are you doing? Answer that honestly and just say, I'm not, you know, we always say I'm fine. But if you're not fine, lean into your vulnerability, because that vulnerability will help you make that connection. And the other M is mastery. You know, talking about a routine, master your routine. If you have a hobby that you always wanted to spend some more time with, perhaps you have the time now, work on it. It could be your professional life. If something you wanted to get better at, get that sense of, I can do this and I own this, because in today's time, a lot of people are feeling helpless, right? Yeah. The uncertainty causes the helplessness, and maybe if you do the mastery part, it'll get you there. And so, you know, looking at these from that perspective, you know, really, really helps our well-being. And to the elderly point, you know, I think while we always think of elderly as fragile, I personally would like to reframe that that narrative. You know, the folks who are elderly, they have a lot of perspective on life, and that perspective really actually helps them sort of frame this crisis and differently than young individuals. Mm-hmm. So I'll kind of hand it over to Jenny here, but I feel like we have a lot to learn from our elderly, as and not only just we need to support them for sure, we need to be there for them, that through that connection part, through mobility, mindfulness, mastery, but more so learn from them, because they have something to share with us, because they've gone through something like this in their past, you know. So
thank you. I totally agree. I think there's so many opportunities. And one of the things, you know, to emphasize, you mentioned mindfulness. Yeah. And that is a word that we hear more and more these days. But really what it's talking about is learning to be in the present moment. Mm-hmm. And that is so essential right now. Trying to think about, what can I control? What is happening right here, right now? With all of the media attention, with all of the constant bombardment of information, it's hard to really wade through that and say, what can I do? Mm-hmm. So I find that mindfulness is really about learning to attune to your five senses, really pay attention to your environment and what is happening right here, right now. Paying attention to what are your thoughts, your emotions, your physical sensations. Like, are you somebody that when you're feeling overwhelmed, all of a sudden you've got muscle tension? Mm-hmm. Pay attention to that and use those body cues to take a moment to stop, to take a slow, deep breath, to ground where you're at. We can predict and we can worry about all the potential outcomes, but we're not going to be able to worry about every possible scenario. So sometimes taking a step back and just thinking about, okay, what is going on right here, right now, and what do I have control over, can ease that burden of feeling like the weight of everything is on your shoulders. So mindfulness, there's a ton of apps out there to help you with this, but also thinking just about using your five senses, taking a slow, deep belly breath, and just taking 2 minutes to center and clear your mind.
Yeah, no, that's wonderful. We have just a reminder too, to make sure that you chat in any questions you may have. Mm-hmm. So we'll be with you till 12:30 today. We have a question that was submitted beforehand. It says, how do I talk to my work about feeling uncomfortable and asking for more precautions for myself? I work at a hotel and they aren't addressing the employee concerns.
So, you know, I think this is a question that is being asked so many different places, hospitals, hotels, any kind of office where you have to still go to work. And it's a valid question. And I think if you are somebody who is in a supervisory position or an employer, I think this is a very important question that we need to address and not sort of sidestep. It's an uncomfortable question as well. So I think this, the first thing I would recommend or suggest is, you know, just be there in the present moment, and with your words, with your body language, be there for the person who's asking that question. That's the first important step. I am listening to you. I'm there for you. And once you demonstrate that, you start to build the trust. That person who's asking that question has a lot of fear, anxiety, and probably feeling helpless. And the next thing is to, after you sort of listen in with your mind and your body, you validate that question. You say, you know, I try to see the world from their eyes. That's the next step towards building the trust. And then once you kind of create that bridge, then it makes it easier to, how do we solve this together? Yes, I hear you. Yes, this is an issue. Validating that, and then creating that sense of partnership. You and I, we are in this together. I feel the same thing you feel. I'm afraid too. Let's work on on it together. And once you create that sense of collaboration, that togetherness, the mindset that we are operating out these days, the mindset of scarcity, can shift towards mindset of abundance. When you feel like, even when you feel like you don't have enough of something, when you start to work together, when you start to talk about it honestly, you can create something that works for everybody with what you have. So I think that's the framework that I would like to suggest. You know, and sometimes, you know, it's okay if we can't solve the problem. Sometimes there are such situations that you tried, you gave it your best shot, and you can't solve it. And being honest about it, you know, and showing that you really, really tried, that also helps.
Yeah. Here's a situation too that could come up. You know, all of a sudden the world changed overnight.
Right.
And so I am stuck at home. I feel a little listless. You know what? I sleep a lot more. I'm watching TV and videos and streaming online. Is this healthy? And what should I be doing if I feel like in the mornings I can't get out of bed? It's better just to sleep in.
Yeah. So I think that is happening to a lot of people. And that goes back to some of the conversations that we've already had about mastery and structure and routine. So really trying to have that mindset. I know so many people that are working from home that, you know, when I've talked to them, they are staying in pajamas, they're not getting dressed, and going through your normal routine, getting dressed, doing your hair, you know, taking a shower, eating your breakfast, having your cup of coffee, whatever it might be, those things really do emphasize that sense of normalcy in this new normal that we're experiencing. So having as much structure as you can, if you've got kids at home, that structure is chaos. Mm-hmm. And, you know, so many of our caregivers and individuals across the country are learning to be teachers now, that, you know, our educators are doing so much to make the education available, but it still falls back on the parents to implement that. So again, having some sort of structure and also setting expectations for yourself. And not expecting that you are going to have your makeup done and that you're gonna be, you know, on 100% and you're gonna be as productive as you were if you were in the office, or that your kids are going to be doing 6 hours of schoolwork every day. I think it's about trying. I think it's about the effort and really acknowledging your limits and taking breaks, but being kind and giving that sense of compassion, not only to yourself, but having compassion for others and grace. And I think that compassion is really what we all need right now.
And I would also add, like, you know, you mentioned about information, and I think you touched upon it as well. And, you know, there's the sense of being overwhelmed with information these days. There's information coming from every which way, and most of it can be quite alarming these days. And so and something that I'm also personally doing is limiting the sources of information, because everybody's trying to get your attention through some type of alarmist sort of narrative. And that's the kind of media economy, it's called the attention economy we live in. So I think just kind of limit your information from sources that you trust. Try not to keep checking the information hour upon hour. Say, I'm gonna check it twice a day. And just also, you know, recognizing the fact that you're worried, identifying that emotion or the feeling, I'm worried. And maybe setting some time aside on a daily basis that you this is the 20 minutes or 30 minutes I'm going to, it's my worry time.
Thank you.
You know, and better still, if you set aside that time, pick up a paper and a pencil or a pen and write your worries down. That will, you know, it's almost magical, you know, because once you write your worries down and you set yourself that worry time and you walk away, you will feel so much lighter and unburdened. and there'll be a little skip in your step. So give it a try.
That is one of my favorite therapy techniques, is to have that worry time. Yeah. And really being intentional about that is when you worry. So when you notice the worries coming up at other times of the day, saying, nope, I have a time for that, and really trying to honor that and return to what you were doing before. The other piece that I find particularly helpful when it comes to worry time is to end any worry time practice with gratitude. Mm-hmm. That gratitude is a really amazing small way, but has such intense impact to really kind of shift your mindset away from all the negative, because there is so much negative, but there's also so much amazing positive that I've seen day in and day out, just communities coming together and just so much happening that is, you know, available to be grateful for. And that's what we want to focus on.
And I want to say that gratitude is a big part, I think, of what you, Dr. Sachiva, have pushed it at Swedish also, because we internally for our caregivers had a gratitude garden.
Yeah.
Where we could go on and actually send our caregivers messages of support and appreciation. And I gotta say, it has been so nice to have this today, because surrounded by these two, I feel really relaxed, I feel comfortable, it's going well, stress-free. But we have an exciting element of that gratitude garden as we were talking about this show and how we could help the public.
Right, it's so opportune. I don't want to miss the opportunity to say, I'm so grateful you brought this up. So, you know, and I truly mean that. And as I've sort of, we all are on a personal journey of wellness, and I've sort of been on this journey for some time. You know, I've learned through practice the immense power of gratitude. At first, kind of, I was skeptical about it, but as I started practicing it and making myself write down my feelings about gratitude, I began to notice a sense of calmness, a sense of positivity inside of me, and the power of spreading that positivity. It's not about minimizing the dire circumstances we find ourselves in. It's about finding the areas of sunshine and then picking up those sprinkles of sunshine and then dropping them elsewhere. Think about gratitude as that. You're spreading sunshine. And there's so much scientific data around gratitude that if you think of it as an exercise, and if you exercise that gratitude muscle, we actually get stronger. And not only mentally stronger, but it helps our physical well-being. And there's data out there that it also helps your immune system. And now more than ever, we need a healthier, stronger, more vigilant immune system. So it's just a win-win-win situation. And with that in mind, and again, my focus has been, how do I care? How do we care for our caregivers? It just was very obvious that we really need to practice gratitude as a community. And with that in mind, we set up a webpage internally for our caregivers to just write down their thoughts, like just, you know, any, I call it moments of excellence or kindness. If you see that, just capture it and send it to us. So it's almost like a Twitter feed within Swedish, so 52 words or less. And by golly, it's taken off. And so we've been tracking internally the number of hits that page gets, and it's number one in our wellness page. Of all the hits that our wellness page is getting, people are actually going to that gratitude garden, looking at, seeing it blossom, reading the notes of gratitude. And I feel so good about it that we are spreading that positivity, building that resilience, building that gratitude muscle. So the next thought was, hey, this is going really well. How do we spread it within our community? Because I know there are folks in our community who are noticing these acts of kindness, these areas of sunshine. And how do we sprinkle the sunshine throughout? And I'm also hearing from my neighbors that, hey, how can I express my sense of gratitude because I went and got healthcare, and now more than ever, when everybody's running away from the fire, our healthcare workers are actually running towards the fire. They're putting their lives online and helping other folks. And then how do I convey my sense of gratitude? So
So you started we started an external site.
Right.
You want to talk about
that? So within days, you know, again, the sense of urgency and the positive energy that was there, something that would have taken probably weeks, maybe months to do it, we did it within a matter of days. And we stood up a website that mirrors our internal gratitude garden. So we now have an external gratitude garden that folks would like to share their words of gratitude just about anything. But my request is, if you this would be a great time for you to share words of gratitude towards a healthcare worker, anybody, somebody who's working in our EVS or environmental services, somebody who's working in our kitchen, somebody who's working in our plant ops that keeps our hospitals running, folks that you probably don't see that much, and certainly our nurses, our technicians, our doctors. This would be a great time to share what the words of gratitude you might have towards them, because these folks, they really need it, and it will be a shot of positivity for our healthcare workers.
Yeah, and we pop that up on frame so people can see that opening page, and we will give you the actual website. I think it's Swedish Foundation/Gratitude Garden. Yeah. If anyone wants to comment and leave a message and share it,
we would be very grateful for that, and it would mean a lot.
And then to balance it out, as we've discussed that, you know, it's kind of a balancing act. You have the gratitude and positivity, but you have to balance it with the anxiety that people are actually feeling in today's world. And you know, something that's, I think, very much on people's mind is their job. Mm-hmm. Like, what if I'm worried that I may lose my job through this? There's so many industries shutting down and closing doors. How should they approach it, or what's your advice?
You know, I think those worries are valid. People are losing their jobs. You know, and I'll put my palliative care hat on. You know, the sense of unease most of us are feeling, that vague sensation, uneasiness that we're feeling, some of it is just grief. Mm-hmm. We are also grieving and identifying that emotion, that feeling of loss, that we have lost something that we felt was so normal is not there anymore. And it, you know, we have to confront that grief. We have to acknowledge it. We have to process that grief. And I think it's really important to identify, starting with the identification. You know, so I think that's where I would say, like, you know, the worry is real. People are losing their jobs. There's a sense of grief. But then when I talk to patients as a palliative care physician, and these are folks who are in really, really dire circumstances from a health perspective, what I've also noticed is talking about hope, no matter what our circumstances are, there's always, always, always something to hope for, something positive. And that, again, ties into that our sense of gratitude. But I think knowing that we need to hope for something better, and that positivity has a power of its own. So while not minimizing the circumstances, thinking about, hey, what else can I hope for? What else can I, you know, what is within my power to affect? That sense of mastery, even in the face of loss, you know. So I will kind of like, you know, hand it over to Dr. O'Donnell, because I know she's got.
Thank you. Yeah. No, I really appreciate the reframe of this as grief. That is absolutely a key component of what this is for many people. So working through things as a grief process. While also, you know, knowing what your options are, making yourself aware of the different resources and asking for help. That is really hard for a lot of people. But this is a time where we all need to lean in and lean on each other. Mm-hmm. And so really finding out what your options are, knowing, you know, what Mayor Durkin has done in terms of evictions and, you know, the eviction moratoriums and unemployment opportunities. And, you know, for a lot of the restaurant workers, there's a number of the restaurants that are providing free meals for our restaurant workers that are out of work. And there are so many things happening within our community and so many people stepping up to help each other. So I think from the grief perspective, absolutely acknowledging that, labeling it, understanding what it is that you're feeling, knowing your resources, and asking for help, whether that's from a neighbor, a friend, researching some of the various resources that are available, or connecting with your healthcare providers, connecting with your behavioral health, mental health therapists, and you know, really asking for support. We are all in this together and we all want to support each other. Mm-hmm. So I think reaching out, you know, call first, don't just walk in. But there's so many virtual options right now that mm-hmm. everybody wants mm-hmm. to help each other. So don't be afraid to seek that help.
Yeah, it's really that vulnerability you're talking about mm-hmm. and being able to reach out and talk about it so mm-hmm. that so that it's actually on the table, right? And that people can respond to that and help you. We're quickly running out of time. I just have one last question. We had discussed briefly before we went live, the whole, what should we expect in terms of this progression of anxiety and the unknown? Like, what are some of the steps?
You know, I mean, this is unprecedented, right? I mean, none of us have lived through a pandemic. While there are so many projections out there, let's just call and acknowledge the fact that there's uncertainty. Mm-hmm. But you know, what there's no uncertainty about is how do I respond to it? One thing that I have in my control 100% is not the event that happened, but how do I respond to that event? And I think what we talked about is the tools that help us sort of modulate our response in a way that helps us grow. And I wanted to kind of bring that part, like while there's uncertainty and while we are going through this trauma and while we will have individuals who will have post-traumatic stress, are currently having it, will have it. What I've learned from reading about it, and Dr. Nall can comment, is that there's also post-traumatic growth. More people who go through trauma and stressful situations actually experience post-traumatic growth than compared to those who experience post-traumatic stress. So I want us also to focus on that while not minimizing the harmful effects of what we are going through. You mentioned virtual visits, and just part of this whole adversity and trauma that we, all healthcare systems, our communities are going through, we have seen tremendous amount of innovation. Something that would have taken years, many healthcare systems, including ours, we've just migrated to virtual visits like in a blink of an eyelid. And we are now having thousands of virtual visits that were just unthinkable 2 weeks ago, so.
Yeah, I would absolutely echo all of that. The growth is something that I think we're all gonna experience to some degree, at least that's my hope. And yes, it's not to minimize the struggle or the challenges that we're going through and we will be going through. This is a marathon that we're currently sprinting and it's exhausting and we're all gonna be fatigued. And at the same time, there is so much innovation, there's so much that has been coming out of this in terms of how our communities are coming together that life is never gonna be the same. I truly believe that this has shifted our world and our normal is going to be different. And that doesn't have to be bad. It can really be something that has emphasized some really great things about our community.
So as we close this out today, I just want to ask each of you to give me your one piece of advice or one thing that you would have the folks out there do today.
Today, stay present. Really just take a few moments to express a moment of gratitude and to really feel the grass, feel the, mm-hmm. you know, feel the rain, feel whatever is in your environment, hug someone, but really
physical distancing.
Hug someone that's already in your home.
There you go.
But, you know, or a virtual hug. But connect. So those would be kind of my key pieces.
Perfect. Thank you, Dr. Sipchidibu.
You know, I just want to echo what Dr. O'Donnell said. And I think just, you know, I would say pick up the phone, write a letter. I think that creating that meaningful connection is so very important. And through that, once you have that connection, you can lean into your vulnerability. You can share your thoughts. You can share your gratitude. And perhaps just kind of make it a point like, hey, every day or every week, I'm going to reach out to one or two new individuals that I haven't done so and create those sense of friendships and expand your sense of community.
Well, thank you to both of you doctors and to all of you. Thank you for watching with us this past half hour. We try to do this as a weekly program with different topics to get your questions answered live. And I guess my advice to everyone is please stay home and stay healthy. Thank you.